Today's message from Reverend Christian Sorensen was recorded October 30th, 2016. It's titled Heart of the Matter, subtitled From This Way, I Live From My Heart. To end today's message, we've also included the spirit, talent, and beautiful voice of our special guest and musical artist, Angela Travis, and included a link to her Facebook page on the show notes at joyouspodcast.com. Come visit us at seasidecenter.org sometime, or join us in Encinitas, California, where we always have great music, a spirited message, and a joyful, loving, vibrant community that awaits you.
Feel the joy, feel the peace, and the comfort of home, 'cause all are welcome here. Yes, all are welcome here. Oh,
man, that could be Dorothy's song. You know, you got to love the story that got you here, but choose your change. It's like, wow, that works. My goodness, because we all have stories, right? Yeah, we do. I've been in foundation class enough to hear a few. So, but, you know, that doesn't stop us. There's a dream. There's something inside of us that is stirring our soul and our spirit. And our head has these questions, but there is a heart that softens that. And this morning's segment of The Wizard of Oz, if you would, really is about the blending of the head and the heart, right? You got the scarecrow who wanted some brains, but we knew he had brains even though he didn't know it, because there Dorothy and he were out in the forest, and Dorothy grabbed an apple and a tree got mad at her and slapped her up the side of the head, where she said, you know what? I realize I'm not in Kansas anymore. It's like, really? Not always do trees. But the scarecrow used his brain and said, hey, watch this. Hey, your apples are no good. They're rotten anyway. And they started throwing them. And they started picking them up. And they had their apples. And it worked wonderfully. And, you know, it led her to the Tin Man. You guys got to check this guy out afterwards. Ginny and her sister Val did an incredible job with this. Yeah, wait till you see the eyes. Man, it looks, yeah, it's those two. Jack Haley, the original scarecrow there. Well, not really the original. You know, it was Buddy Epson. It was supposed to be the original scarecrow. They cast him, and the first time he wore his costume, they painted him in aluminum paint, and it just made his lungs go bad, and he couldn't breathe, and he went down, and they had to do it without him. So Jack Haley got second shot and did a great job for sure. But here's Dorothy. Comes across this tin dude, and it's like, you know, wow, he's a man. And he starts pounding on the chest and got this, oil, oil can, and she finds the oil can and starts, you know, oiling up the different kind of joints, and he starts moving, and when he starts dancing, you know, if I only had a heart, I mean, how often have we wished, if they only had a heart, you know, they may not be so nasty, you know, may not be so mean. If I only had a heart, I could realize I could change, that, you know, there is a greater possibility here. If I only had a heart, but, you know, it's like oil isn't where it's all at. All of a sudden, he got moving. But it takes more in life than just to move. You got to have the heart. You got to have the soul. Sometimes, you know, we can get ourselves going, but we're not into it. Know what I mean? Yeah. It's like in the morning, you got to get going instead of oil. Coffee, yeah, here I go. Boom, out there. And you're going in life, but your heart's not in it. You got to get your heart, you got to get soul, you got to get your spirit in it so you can get out there and grooving. Because if you stop to think when this, we got Cat in the Hat back there. Oh my goodness, I didn't see you. How fun. It's quite unique standing up here and seeing all these costumes. We're going to stay focused here. But anyway, where was I going? So that's what I was saying. You should see what goes on in here. It's amazing. it's really here, not there. So 1899 it was written. It was like the Industrial Revolution was going on, right? I mean, machines were replacing human beings in the farms and the factories. All of a sudden, it was the machination of our society, and people were afraid that humans weren't going to be needed anymore. You know, machines don't have the heart. They have the robotic expression. But have you noticed people haven't become obsolete yet? We've gone from 1 billion to 7 billion, so we're like being utilized more than ever before. But now we got the fear technology. So instead of looking like a tin man, we could be taught like computer or AI, artificial intelligence is going to take over. They're going to put, you know, chips in our brain or whatever. The technology is moving so fast. We now communicate with, you know, whether it's the computer, whether it's with email, whether it's with the tweets or the texts or the Snapchats, or it goes on. And we use our cell phone that we buy this month that's obsolete by next month. It is crazy the way things are progressing. But I want you to get that no matter what kind of intelligence or technology comes up, they'll never replace the heart. The heart is where it's at. That's where the spirit downloads into your expression. All our ancestors, not all, but our ancestors knew this. I mean, the ancient Greeks considered the heart the seat of the soul. Did you know that? Mesopotamians considered the heart the seat of the soul. The Babylonians considered the heart the seat of the soul. The Egyptians made it really famous. You know that hieroglyphic where they wear the feather against the heart? I got it, in case you don't. Thanks, Marv. But Anubis brings down whoever transitioned over into the other life. And Osiris is sitting there and he's weighing, you know, the god of the afterlife of immortality weighs the person's feather against the heart to see, is it as light, is your heart as light as a feather? And then you got Thor scribing, you know, the underworld guy just taking this. And if your heart is as light as a feather, you get to go on, you get to keep going. If not, you got some more stuff to learn. You got to go back. They got some nasty things like we do too that kind of prompt you to keep going, doing good. But you know what? It's not it. You either got it this go around or, you know what? You just bought yourself another lifetime. It's like, that's okay. You get to come back. And you know what? You get one of these bodies to house your soul. See, that's wonderful. This body of ours, it's a blessing. But we get caught up in just the mind. There's more than the mind. If I were to ask you to point, where's the seat of your soul? I'm looking. There's not one person that went like this. You know, nobody pointed to their brain. You know, there's something inside of us that says it's inside. You know, our spirit is moving right here, and this heart of ours is amazing. You know, we think, hey, the brain is where the thinking goes on, but our ancient ancestors didn't think so. And now science is proving that the neurons are not only firing in the brain, they're firing in the heart. Science has shown that there are neurons that are firing and wiring from the heart, just like the brain, that are giving information and giving insights to the brain. It is the pulse, the blood that is pumping. You pump, like the heart weighs less than a pound. It pumps 11 pints of blood a minute, which works out to 2,000 gallons a day. Times 365, that's 700,000 gallons of blood that's pumping through your system. And it's pumping intelligence. It is pumping and the pulsing, and it's communicating with the brain and the rest of your body. You know, you got the chemical stuff coming out of your brain in the atrial peptides that are communicating on what to release within your body. It's electrical. You know, that's why you do EKGs. It catches your electric pulse of the heart. That's they're firing there. You know, if you're out of balance or the rhythm in your heart is off, what do? They go in and they shock the heart. They give it a little electrical juice and boom, it gets it back into balance. This heart of ours is an amazing, amazing expression, and it can do incredible things, but we've got to believe that it's so. Because the head wants to take over. You know, Ray Bradbury, you know, he said, don't listen only to your intellect, because you'll never have a love affair. Friendships, start a new business. You know, it's too cynical. You got to jump off the cliff and build your wings on the way down. That is only what your heart will do, because your logical mind says, we can't start this or we can't go there because, you know, the heart says, you know what? Quiet. I hear you. You make some sense, but you know what? There's a soul here. There's a spirit here. There's something that's alive, but it gets turned off at an early age. You know how it gets turned off? It's because we have well-meaning people trying to domesticate us with the shame and the blame, and you act like this, and you will be loved. That's how you get loved. Don't express necessarily yourself, but there's this little kid came home from nursery school and said, Mom, I need to take a bath. Mommy, I need to take a bath. He said, why? He said, I got something on me. I don't know what. I said, oh, yeah, what'd you get on you? He said, I said something, and the teacher waved her finger at me and said, shame on you. I said, I don't know what the shame is, but it doesn't feel very clean. I need to wash it off. But you know, look at the finger. It's just like an energetic. You know, if you had the evil witch going, it'd be her magic wand, rubbing it on you. Nah, nah, nah. Or shaking it out. Boom, boom, like Harry Potter. Boom, boom, boom. You know, and so all of a sudden you're hit with this shame and this guilt. And I got to tell you, those that live in shame see shame. Those who live in innocence see innocence. They don't see shame. They don't see guilt. Know that have a guilty consciousness, project guilt on others. And well-meaning parents, they like shame and guilt their kids into behavior, and they got to live with that heaviness the rest of their life. They don't get what a detriment it is to us to be inflicted with that kind of garbage. Not that we have to accept it, but when you're a five-year-old, how do you know the difference if somebody's telling you do that or something horrible is going to happen? It's like, wow, that's just nasty stuff. You know, God is not angry at you. You got that? This is really important. Anybody who's holding on to some guilt from past stuff, you know, God is love, right? That's the heart of the matter here. That's what we're talking about, the heart of the matter. You know, it's like God's not angry. Life's not angry at you. You got that? Yeah, but not just up here. Here. It's got to be cellular. It's got to pump through your body and your system. Do you ever remember the movie The Mission? Mendoza. He was a slave trader down in South America. He would kidnap some of the indigenous people from the mountain tribes and sell them to plantation owners. And one day when he came home, he found his brother in bed with his very own fiance. And he just went angry and berserk and ended up killing his brother. Filled with remorse, guilt, and all those horrible things, he couldn't function. So he checked himself in, that's into a mission. And to self-inflicted penance, what he did is he tied a big, huge bag of heavy metal weaponry, and he committed himself to dragging that through his world for the rest of his life. And if you remember the movie, he climbed Iguazu Falls in Argentina, which is like the Niagara Falls down there. He finally gets to the top, and as he gets to the top of the waterfalls, he sees the tribe of people that he had been kidnapping. And one of the warriors looked down at him and pulled a big knife out of his pocket. Mendoza figured this was it, and he just leaned back to be stabbed. The guy took his knife and leaned over, and rather than putting it in his chest, he cut the heavy weight of bag from his side, and you just watch it get thrown and fall into the falls and the river down below. Talk about symbolically letting go of the past, of the penance, of being forgiven, to the point where his life changed. See, that's the thing, change. You got to be willing to change, and sometimes you're going to burn on this path. Dorothy and the Scarecrow and the Tin Man, they went through some very horrific time. Literally, they were toast. Sometimes you just got to burn it away. Sometimes you got to be burned to the place before you can shine bright. You've got to recognize this story that I'm living in my life. My brain is saying, this is bad stuff. But you know what? That story has been perfect for you to be able to change into the next expression of who you are. The Course in Miracles says, no matter what you think will come of your sin, it's never going to happen. What you think is going to come of that sin, just don't believe it. It's not going to happen. That's not it. Life is not angry at you. You are the one who's tied the heavy burden that you are carrying through life until you decide it's time to let go. Eleanor Roosevelt said that no one can make you feel inferior without your consent. Hello is right. Without your consent, you cannot be made to feel bad. It's up to you to decide. You know what? What's going on here? I get to decide that I don't need to control this situation, or I don't need to inflict the guilt upon other people. I don't need to play God here. You know, people would stop playing God if they came to realize that they were already God. You know? That they're already that. And that if you don't have heart in something, nothing is possible. But if you've got heart and your spirit's in it, everything is possible. You know, Schuller, remember Robert Schuller? Crystal Cathedral guy. He said that once you feel that you have exhausted all possibilities, remember this, okay? So once you feel you've exhausted all possibilities, you got any of those in your life? He said, remember this. I haven't told you yet. But he said, remember this. You haven't. And sometimes it's not coming from the brain. It's coming from the heart. It's coming from the soul. It's coming from, you know what? I need to step into this. I got to be willing to burn in the fire here. I got to be willing to go down the yellow brick road and go through the poppies and the forests and the fires and the castles and deal with the witches and the challenges. I got to be willing to submit myself to the flames because this is my story and this is my path. And it's not bad. It's just my path right now. And I am going to triumph over this because there's something inside of me that knows that I am accepting something greater for my life and in my life. You see, we've been talking about prosperity principles because in a couple weeks we're coming together on Pledge Sunday and I'm telling you and reminding you so it's not a surprise. You don't think I'm dropping it on you. We've been working on our lives to create greater abundance. And in a few weeks we're going to take a look, hey, how are we going to support the wonderful vision of Seaside? But the prosperity principles I shared, remember from the first week, was Dorothy. It was about expectancy. She expected to find the wizard. She expected to go home. She didn't know what was going to be on her path in her journey. But she was willing to share that path and that journey. See, those are a couple of keys. One is expectancy, two, a willingness to share of it. And last week we spoke about the brain's part, the law of attraction kind of thing. You know, where is it? Well, this week I want us to get acceptance. It's important for us to be able to accept the good because it's here. You know, just listen to your heart. I mean, you know, if you need to make a decision, your head can't get to it. Ask yourself something and touch your heart while you're doing that. Go ahead and try that. You don't have to say it out loud, but you got a question? See, there's something in you that knows, doesn't it? That's right. It's a wonderful exercise to practice at home when you got a tough decision. Where am I going to go with this? I'm at the fork in the road. And just, okay, God, the heart knows. The heart of the matter here is what is the highest and best. And so as I begin to step into acceptance, what then becomes apparent is I need to release and let go of something. It's an important part, you know. Tarzan can't swing through the jungle holding on to one vine. You know, you gotta let go and let go and let go. You've got to be willing to release. You know what? I feel safe in Munchkin Town, but you know what? There's an Emerald City that has something greater waiting for me. And I'm willing to step onto that path. I'm willing to face whatever comes my way. But as long as you're holding on to something. I remember first a spiritual center. I used to go visit this one woman who was bedridden. She hadn't been out of bed for years. Her husband was just devoted, sympathetic, angel, God sent, took care of her. She never had to worry. And then he died. And the prognosis was, you know, convalescent home or get better. Well, she didn't want to go to the convalescent home. And all of a sudden, she started eating a little, I don't know, healthier, started thinking friends would come visit her. Then she would go out with the friends. The next thing you know, she was going out on her own. She was shopping. And she got up and she started living on her own. And she wasn't sick another day in her life. Yeah. You got to be willing to let go. And you're sometimes holding on to things. It's your mind that says, I don't know, greater good can't really be waiting for me. Yeah, it is. Yeah, it is. You know what? But I've got to be willing to allow the circumstances to change. I've got to get into a place of expectancy and realize right now my greater good is unfolding, that the circumstances and the possibility are beyond what my brain has thought heretofore, and I'm going to be receptive to it. I'm not going to hold on to what was. Remember the story last week? I was talking about Joshua had gone up and looked at the promised land. Moses sent a dozen spies up, and he and Caleb were the two that came back and said, hey, promised land. The other said, no way, we're not going in there. They got giants and walls, and it's not good. And in Numbers, in the Bible, it said they wept by the fire and said, let's go back. Meaning, let's go back to the bondage of Egypt. That is better than facing what is new. You got to let go. Those two were able to accept the greater good, and the others, who were the majority of the collective consciousness, vote one out, and they had to wait 40 years before all that old stuff died away so it could be released before those that were able to accept the greater experience of the promised land could be fulfilled, before it could be answered. You know what? You have got to be willing to claim your good. I got this affirmation for you. Marv, let's run this. That's it. Okay, it says, let's read it together. I take the good from my experiences and I let the rest go. I am not hypnotized by appearance. I now recognize a new set of circumstances as possible. God, I am ready. I accept and claim my highest good now. How do you like that? Woo! Let's say it one more time now that we got it down together. I take the good from my experience and I let the rest go. I am not hypnotized by appearances. I now recognize a new set of circumstances as possible. For God, I am ready, and I accept and claim my highest good now. There you go. That is how this prosperity principle works, is accepting your good now. But listen to what's stirring in your soul and your heart. Recognize that, you know what? You have got something that knows how to do that, but you've got to listen to the totality of your body. But we so often don't take care of the body. I mean, there's a lot of societies that believe you take care of this body. You honor this body, you enjoy this body, you love this body. Clarissa Pinkola Estes, you know, authoress of Women Who Run with the Wolves, she said, your body, it is a loyal, royal, dedicated companion that was born for your soul in this world. You've got to learn to take care of that. You know, if you're hungry, a lot of times people don't eat. If you're thirsty, you don't drink. If you're tired, Red Bull. If you had a friend come over, say, hey, Chris, man, I'm hungry. First thing I say, hey, let's go eat. That's not like, hey, starve. Yeah. You're tired? Hey, take a nap. But this body of ours, you know, the spirit moves. It's the head and the heart. It is the marriage that works there, because we, on this path, you know, we come across things. You know, we are programmed. We're going to behave a certain way. I'm going. But life will throw us, and can I respond? Because my whole sensory system is able to respond to that. Here's a video. You know the basketball game, probably. You've seen that Disney did this movie, this kid who made all these shots at the end. Well, it's not that.
Coach Peter Morales of the Coronado High School Thunderbirds in El Paso, Texas, makes no qualms about it. He has a favorite on this team.
Mitchell, I need you. I need you to help me out with my coaching tips, Mitchell.
Team manager Mitchell Marcus has a developmental disability.
One, two, three, bang!
And he far surpasses everyone here when it comes to love of the game.
He's this amazing person that our basketball team loves being around.
Yay!
Mitchell's mom, Amy, says he's always been that way.
Mitchell always had a basketball. That was always what he wanted for his birthday.
And because basketball is that important to him, on the last game of the regular season, the coach told Mitchell to suit up.
What was it like to put on the uniform?
I was very happy.
I imagine you were.
Just wearing a jersey was enough for Mitchell. But what he didn't know, what no one knew at the time, was that the coach planned to play him at the end, no matter what the score.
You were prepared to lose that game?
For his moment, yes. For his moment in time, yes.
And so, with a minute and a half left, Coronado leading, but only by 10, Coach Morales put in his manager.
And just started hearing Mitchell, Mitchell.
But here's where the fairy tale fell apart. Although his teammates did everything they could to get Mitchell a basket, each time they passed him the ball, he either missed the shot or, like on their last possession, booted it out of bounds, turning the ball over to the other team with just seconds left.
He wasn't going to be able to score. But I was hoping that he was happy that he was just put in the game.
Could you have ever imagined what happened next?
No, I didn't. I could not. Not at all.
What happened next happened on the inbound. The guy with the ball there is a senior at Franklin High School. Number 22, Jonathan Montañez.
I was raised to treat others how you want to be treated. Just thought Mitchell deserved his chance, deserved his opportunity.
I think I'll cry about it for the rest of my life.
What Jonathan did was yell out Mitchell's name, then threw the ball right to him, right there. One of the most memorable turnovers of all time. It wasn't the game-winning shot. When the buzzer sounded, Coronado had 15 more points than Franklin. But Jonathan's assist and Mitchell's basket did change the outcome decidedly. Play any game with this much sportsmanship. Both teams win. Steve Hartman, On the Road, in El Paso, Texas.
Yeah. That's heart. Yeah, that's heart. Does it make sense? The brain that says win, dominate. That's heart. You know, Jean Houston ends this chapter in her book, The Wizard of Us, about social artistry. And that coach was a social artist. He had committed his passion and his life to working with these kids. And in that moment, he saw an opportunity that allowed spirit to enter into the game even more. You know, being a social artist is taking the passion and the skill and the commitment that you have to the social reality that you're living in and making a difference with what it is you've got. You know, this week a number of us, including your president, Rick, was at the Evolutionary Leaders Conference to engage spirituality. And we listened to a gentleman, Nippon Matt, who is out of the San Jose area. And he started something called the Smile Card. And it's kind of like just an act of kindness and leave the card behind. You know, he had the Karma Cafe where it doesn't cost you anything, just leave some money to pay for the next person's meal. And it's turned into a phenomena. These cards have just gone viral. They're all over the internet. There's millions of kindness stories that are showing up to the point where the president has put him on the commission of kindness for our country, that he serves the president because he has chosen to be expressions of kindness. You know, how is it that you can bring your unique gift into the place? What is it that you love? I don't know if you remember when Lynn Twist or Bill Twist was here at Seaside and they spoke, but she was ahead, I think it was the Hunger Project, and worked with one day in Beverly Hills with people giving her $1 million contributions. Then the next day she'd be over in Africa sitting by a fire talking to the grandmothers and working on how to get funding for some food. And she said that she and her husband just received this call from the Ecuadorian rainforest, not a phone call, but something in their heart, in their soul that didn't really make sense. And they went down, they spoke to the Hakara indigenous people who said, you know what, civilization is encroaching, the oil companies are taking, you know, there's trouble down here. And she said, what can we do? You know, somehow we were brought down here. And they said, what you can do is go home and work on changing the dream of North America. You know, because the dream is exploitation, the oil and the funding and the finances. And if that dream could just change, then everything is going to be okay. See, that's a heart kind of response there. It's like there's something needs to shift here. And I'll tell you what, our earth and our planet is yelling out to us at this time. And are you listening to your heart? And it's not a head that we will dominate, or we're messed up, or there's shame, or there's fear, or there's anger. You know, our nation is going through an election coming up, and the Monday night before the election, the sisters, the Seaside Sisters of Seaside, are getting together Monday night in the garden to sit around a bonfire and drum and pray and hold that high vision and accept the highest and best for our nation and our globe. Not against anything, just that place of acceptance for spirit to show up in a greater way. And then all day on election day, we have a polling booth here, they're going to be sitting outside in the garden praying all day. You know, instead of a flash mob singing, they're going to have a flash mob meditating out here. That's what social artistry does. Go Seaside and go you, because as you rise in your self-expression, you're going to make a difference not only in your life, in your world, but upon this planet. If it's about the heart of the matter, then you can hear the heart of this earth just crying out. We are living in a mythic time for sure. So, polar caps are melting, 17 species a day becoming extinct. We are living in times where we have technology that connects us in a beautiful and amazing way. We have watched Gandhi bring down the British Empire through nonviolence. We put a person on the moon. 100 years ago, women couldn't vote, and one might actually be president. You know, we are living in mythic times that calls for your social artistry. It calls for your heart and soul to get beyond the brain and say, there are possibilities beyond the circumstances right now. And I'm being called. I can feel it stirring in my heart, my body, and my soul. And I know there is greater good that is seeking. And if everyone were to listen to that stirring, then it doesn't matter the judgment that the mind has, the heart has a sense of acceptance. It doesn't matter how critical and cynical the mind is. There is a belief that is within the heart that you have been called to this earth for a time such as this, and you may head down this road, and you may meet the fire, and you may burn, but you know what? Out of those ashes will come that for which you have been called to be. You will shine brighter than ever before when you say, yes, God, yes, heart, yes, spirit, yes, I am here to be used. And you will dance down this yellow brick road, grateful for the story that you have lived and the changes that you are choosing in your life, because you're no longer victim to the manipulated mind thoughts, but rather I can be in the game where I am to win or achieve this goal, and something can show up that is more beautiful, that makes everybody a winner. So join us as we head down this yellow brick road. Marv?
Pause? Tours.
Pause. God bless us as we discover that wizard that is within us. Let's keep it going as we bring back this one. It's time for Angel Travis to warm our hearts, to warm our souls.
Holy God. I can't, just 1 second. The timing of this. Why does this always happen here? Woohoo! Seaside. Okay, guys, you're in for it now. I can feel my change. Through armor of flame, I can still breathe you in the dark, 'cause you're the light and you're my spark. You forge me in your fire, you make me bright, you make me strong. I wanna be like your fire, blazing love, blazing love. No hurt can stay too long. No hate can last forever. No, the body gives way to the light. You see, then we are free of all our human lies. You forge me in the fire, you make me strong. I want to be like your fire, blazing love, blazing love, only blazing your love. Oh,
You forge me in the fire. You make me brave. You make me strong. Oh my God, I want to be like your fire. Blazing low, blazing low, blazing love. I want to be your fire. I want to be the known and the unknown.
That's Angel Travis. Oh my goodness.